Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Joan Garry's Guide to Nonprofit Leadership, Second Edition, by Joan Garry. Narrated by Joan Garry. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you may hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Preface to the Second Edition. March 2017. I stood on a chair, I'm short, to offer remarks to clients, friends, family, and colleagues to celebrate the publication of my first book. Not gonna lie, it was exciting. A book. People saw me as this expert, someone who could help them figure out the gnarly knots that stood between them and the pursuit of their nonprofit mission. Little did I know then what an imposter I was. Well, maybe that is overstating a bit, but I had no idea how much more there was to know, how many more leaders there were to meet and hear from, and as a result, how much more advice there was to share with you that could be helpful. In this second edition, I add two major stories and a big dose of hope in a world that is more than just a little hungry for it. Story number one. In 2015, I came to understand just how many small nonprofits there were. As the popularity of my blog and podcast grew, now reaching folks from 150 countries around the world, I became something of a Dear Abby. And this Abby became totally overwhelmed with dozens of emails weekly from folks with challenges galore. While they often seemed insurmountable to the writer, I felt like I could help. I had advice for them, resources, and I could give them the pat on the back they desperately needed. But I couldn't keep up. And as a pleaser personality, leaving these folks hanging was not okay by me. Some research quickly unearthed the reason for the flood of emails. Nearly 70% of all nonprofits have budgets under $500,000. And how much do you think these groups budget for professional development? You guessed it, zero. Armed with all those emails and a digital marketing partner, I launched the Nonprofit Leadership Lab just 2 months after the publication of the first edition of this book. The Nonprofit Leadership Lab provides content and community for board and staff leaders of small nonprofits and is the best online resource of its kind. Since its launch, we have supported over 5,000 leaders, both board and staff. I feel a great sense of pride that we have been able to help so many folks develop new skills, transform their boards, write kick-ass grant proposals, and feel a sense of community with thousands of the U.S. and around the world. But it is what these leaders have taught me that is the main reason I wanted to write this second edition. Two-thirds of the sector stares at cash flow and yet is chock-full of passionate and remarkable founders for whom building and growing an organization is simply not the best and highest use of their magic powers. Hundreds of thousands of nonprofits build their boards the best way they know how, and board members are painfully unclear on the significant leading role they play in their organization's success. Angela Duckworth's book, Grit, The Power of Passion and Perseverance, Scribner, is a first-rate look into the tough stuff people are made of, the role perseverance plays in who we can become. When I spend an hour engaging with our members, that is always the first word that comes to mind, grit. And it compels me to be even more of an advocate and champion for these leaders. And so a deep dive into small nonprofits, how to be an effective one, and what all nonprofits have to learn from the grit and determination of the small nonprofit are additional areas of focus in this edition. Story number two. Actually, it's many stories. Stories that upset me, stories that anger me, and stories that call me to action to use my platform to work to make things different. These stories are all about the power and responsibilities of boards to fully lead and partner with their organizations to move them from messy to thriving. Our sector does a downright poor job recruiting board members, educating them about what the job really is, and holding them accountable. In a monthly column for the Chronicle of Philanthropy, I spoke the truth about boards' abuse of power, that this may just be responsible for more great staff leader attrition than any other factor. The engagement in that piece was off the charts on every one of my social media platforms. Some folks even sent me videos because someone had asked that I see and hear them. Since I wrote the first edition of this book, Boards' Abuse of Power is a recurring theme I hear from members of my leadership lab and from the dozens of my coaching and strategy clients. This issue was prominent for me in 2016 and led me to write Chapter 3, which reframes nonprofit leadership as co-pilots flying a twin-engine jet. Today, I feel a greater sense of urgency as these stories continue to come my way. A lack of understanding of board service is the one thing that most often thwarts the success of a nonprofit organization's efforts to do the good work that is so badly needed. And this is as true of nonprofits with multi-million dollar budgets as it is of the hundreds of thousands of those organizations who struggle to hit $500,000 in revenue. I hope that my new chapter about why boards matter will be a catalyst in a broad and actionable conversation about how to make real and lasting change in this area. Those two stories represent my why about this second edition. Shall we talk about the why now? Since the first edition of this book was published in 2017, we have seen the development of a mindset that is about drawing lines in the sand and building walls, literally and figuratively. We have become a society that is focused on what divides us rather than what unites us. The situation is ugly. People on both sides of the aisle are angry. It seems hopeless. This divisive society will not magically disappear anytime soon. Hardly. And I guarantee you that every American citizen will be fired up, ready to stand up for what they believe in. Folks who have spent their lives on the sidelines or in the stands will be propelled from their seats by you. All you have to do is invite them. And it isn't just because they feel compelled to do something. It's also because they want to be on the side of hope and possibility. And so they will look to those who are leading, and they will see you. And they will want to play for your team that advocates and educates, your team that works to protect our planet and the living creatures who are our neighbors, your team that brings beauty through music and the arts, or reminds us of our history and the shoulders we stand on. I am driven to help you be the best leader you can be, to fuel your ability to lead well, manage well, and have the greatest possible impact, and to encourage you to take time from repairing our world to take good care of yourself. I am writing now amid the most terrifying health crisis of our time, the COVID-19 pandemic. I am watching nonprofits struggle so badly, and at the same time, I am watching them do the most heroic things. Eric Cooper, the president and CEO of the San Antonio Food Bank, saw what he never imagined possible. In 1 week, in April 2020, 10,000 cars lined up waiting for food. Many of the drivers never imagined they would ever need the services that Eric's heroic team provided. Listening as Eric Cooper became emotional on the evening news reminded me that there is such humanity in our sector, such deep empathy. And this has been, for me, one of the real treasures to see in the darkness. I have no crystal ball, but as all of us navigate our way through this crisis, one that reveals so clearly the racial, gender, ability, and class divides in our country, I am certain that nonprofit leaders will continue to need our support and continue to lead us in the direction of a truly civil society. Eric Cooper's story is one of many. You will meet a host of new characters in this new edition. In the past 3 years, I have worked with thousands of leaders whose stories affirm much of what I shared the first time around. Many of these leaders enriched my understanding of the superpowers and the kryptonite of the nonprofit leader. You will meet these characters and hear their stories throughout the book, and I hope that the stories and the lessons within them will be as much of a gift to you as they have been to me. So let's get to it, shall we? Acknowledgments. We are who we are because of the families that raised us. My mom passed away just after I submitted the manuscript for the first edition. I found a paper copy of the cover art for the book in her purse about a month later. It looked well-worn, like the cashiers at Stop and Shop had probably seen it a few times. It made me smile. If I am smart, feisty, and a bit of a dog with a bone about issues that feel important to me, it is because I am my mother's daughter. To steal a line from one of my kids, thanks for birthing me, Mom. My dad taught me the power of being a good coach. I saw him in action during years of being his right hand in Little League dugouts, and I admired him. Offering direction, support, and encouragement, he was not just a coach. He was a champion and an educator, a leader. Everyone wanted to be on his team. I was lucky. I was born into his team. Father Jim Loughran, S.J., of blessed memory, taught my first philosophy class. He challenged me to consider the value of my moral compass, my own intellectual capacity, and the power of inquiry. We are who we are because of the people who shape our thinking during our journey. Attorneys Paula Edelbrick and Suzanne Goldberg represented our family in a precedent-setting case to create a legal connection between our kids and me. These two triggered the activist in me, planting the idea in my head that it was time to get off the sidelines and onto the field. In 1985, Showtime engaged consultants Joan Goldsmith and Ken Cloak. Joan and Ken were evangelists about making teamwork a reality, not a buzzword, in workplaces. And they taught me about the power of difficult conversations. Much of my work today feels like the baton they passed on to me. Yes, this was the village that led me from a solid, happy life to a life with real purpose, leading me to the nonprofit sector and never looking back. During my tenure at GLAAD, I met activists, donors, and volunteers who inspired me to do my best for them. Lessons learned from this journey are too long to list, but special thanks to Heart Monitor Julie and the 5-star staff and board who partnered with me to build an organization to last. And I hope you are lucky enough to find someone like Karen McGee to step into a board leadership role. I can talk about the power of that partnership because I speak from experience with Karen. This book is my chance to reach more people with guidance and direction. My deepest thanks to Scott Paley of Abstract Edge for believing that I had something to say and for working tirelessly to ensure that the message reached far and wide. Without a blog and a podcast, both Scott's idea, there would be no book. The team at my small but very mighty consulting firm has changed and grown since my first edition. I am so grateful to have a team that is as driven to help the helpers as I am. To a person, my team is smart, funny, empathetic, and dedicated. Special thanks to Cindy Pereira, who runs what we jokingly call Joanlandia. "I think you should update your book, Joan," she said offhandedly one day. I think it was the next day we had a signed contract, because that is how Cindy rolls. I'm also deeply grateful to Laura Zelke, the Director of Member Experience for the Nonprofit Leadership Lab. She treats our work together as a vocation, and in this we are kindred spirits. Laura worked closely with me in identifying lab members whose stories would really bring the lessons to life. Thank you so much to Ariel Extut, my book doctor, and Jim Levine, my agent at Levine Greenberg Rostan Literary Agency. Jim was a nonprofit leader in a former life, and I could not have asked for a better advocate who really understands that nonprofits are messy. And of course, I am so grateful to my friends and colleagues at Wiley for believing in me. I am forever grateful to all my clients, members of the Leadership Lab, and the thousands of board and staff leaders who have entrusted their professional development to me and my team through the years. It is a privilege to serve you, and you are all my heroes. Full stop. Lastly, we are who we are because of the families we create. I never thought I'd be so lucky to have one, and I try never to take it for granted. I keep a small paper note in my desk drawer. It reads simply, "You have a colorful family." Amen. Thanks to my three kids, Scout, Ben, and Kit, for letting me catch you, raise you, annoy you, amuse you, and love you with all my heart. And of course, to my legal wife of 7 years and spouse for almost 40, Eileen Opetut. In 1996, she casually suggested I leave the for-profit sector and apply for a nonprofit executive director job. We had three kids under 7 and had just bought a big house, the perfect time for a new low-paying job. She saw, as she always does, what I often miss completely. I was a leader and an advocate ready for a cause. And so began a new chapter in my life, a life that turned from black and white to color the day we met, like Dorothy's arrival in Oz, complete with three munchkins. Introduction. I could have killed my development director. And I don't mean it the way you think. Julie arrived at a quarterly board meeting, but she didn't look quite right. It was hard not to notice that there was something protruding from her blouse. A heart monitor. She flew in from Los Angeles to Chicago, and I flew in from New York. We had not seen each other in a few weeks. Maybe she mentioned something about doctor's appointments, but come on. I was leading a nonprofit trying to save a portion of the world. Who has time for the health and well-being of staff? Clearly not me. I'm sure you're wondering, Julie is fine. Today, she is a clinical psychologist who no doubt helps clients contend with type A oblivious bosses who drive their employees to heart problems. Oh, also, in case you are wondering, the board meeting was a big hit. Julie and I were impressive and on our game, as we usually were. I did get a few comments at the breaks like, "Hey, how's Julie?" or, "Julie looks like the job is taking a toll on her." "No worries," I said, and went on to get an A+ on our board meeting presentation. But wow, who was I? Why did I not tell Julie to turn on her heels and take the next flight home to Los Angeles? I am not utterly clueless, I swear. I would never intentionally try to put Julie, or anyone else for that matter, in harm's way. But nonprofits can cause a person to transform into someone they don't recognize. Why? Because nonprofits are messy. It's inherent in the formula of the unique beast we call a 501c3. A plus B plus C plus a big dose of intense passion equals messy. A, a poorly paid and overworked group, staff, who B, rely on the efforts of people who get paid nothing, volunteers, and are overseen by C, another group of volunteers who get paid nothing and who are supposed to give and get lots of money. Board. All this is in the service of something that every single one of them cares passionately about. Wow. Now that is a recipe for messy. And that organization you care so deeply about can get messier still if it's not led and managed well. I learned the messy lesson the hard way. What did I know? 15 years in corporate America, and then poof, I'm running a nonprofit. More on the poof part in a few. I felt ever so well equipped with my financial skills, my management skills, and my understanding of how to manage a budget and to deliver results. I had never met messy like this until the day I sat down at my desk at GLAAD, one of the largest gay rights nonprofit organizations. Or so I thought. Actually, GLAAD was large by reputation, but large was not the first word that came to mind when I saw that we had $360 in the bank. That was not at all the word that came to mind. It was bad. And I'll admit it here. I felt like a bit of a fraud, soon to be unmasked, as having neither the grit nor the skills to dig us out. There was one very bad day the first week on the job. I remember it well. I was at my computer, writing a solicitation letter to a lapsed donor, trying everything to drive cash in the door. I was pleased with the letter. I sent it to print on the serviceable printer, reviewed it, found a typo. And with that, I burst into tears. It may have been my predicament, but I think it was singularly focused. I knew we could not afford to reorder letterhead. Then there was this other day. I was in Los Angeles meeting with donors and praying they would pick up the tab when my phone rang. It was my deputy director in New York. He calmly said that it might be time to look for office space he knew we couldn't afford. There was an inch of snow on his desk when he arrived for work. Very, very messy. I'm not sure I knew what to expect when I left corporate America for this job. Not sure I did a lot of thinking. My move from the corporate world to the nonprofit world was more of a heart move than a head move. I was not unhappy in the corporate world. Hardly. I'd hit the corporate jackpot. In my first job out of college, I landed on the management team of MTV. Yes, working at MTV in the early 80s was just as cool as you can imagine. I also learned a ton. I learned about the pace, intensity, and thrill of being a part of a startup. More on that later. I learned how to innovate when I wrote the business plan for the MTV Video Music Awards. And my Harvard MBA boss bought me an HP 12C calculator, the calculator that allows people to assume you have an MBA, and taught me about budgets and balance sheets. From MTV, I moved to Showtime Networks. There, I became a very good manager of people. I became a team player. I learned what it meant to be a good corporate citizen as one of the early gay poster children when Showtime began to walk the walk on diversity. We gave money to worthy causes, and I found myself in the early 90s advocating for corporate sponsorship dollars from Showtime to gay organizations. While there, we built a new business, a now dinosaur that we called pay-per-view. And it was there that I learned about boxing. Yes, boxing. Like that thing big, sweaty guys do with gloves on in rings. I learned that people pay a lot of money to watch boxing on TV. And that if you get really good seats at the MGM Grand Hotel in Las Vegas, the flying sweat, well, it flies The most important gift Showtime gave me was the recognition that I had a voice. I became another kind of poster child, essentially an employee advocate for better communication and transparency from the senior leadership. This work, which included hosting a full staff 800 town meeting, was transformative. I found my voice as an advocate for the employees at Showtime. I found my wheelhouse. Now what? I had no idea. I just knew a change was in the offing. There was no aha moment for me. There was just a conversation. My now wife, but then spouse, partner, longtime companion, enter other euphemisms here, came home from work and told me that the executive director job at GLAAD was open. I casually remarked, "You know, somebody like me ought to have a job like that. We have 3 kids, I drive a minivan, and we really do have a white picket fence. That would shake up America's picture of a gay rights activist, huh?" Eileen, who knows how to shake things up in just the right way, casually responded to my casual remark. "Well, then somebody like you should apply." I never in a million years thought they would hire me. I had no nonprofit experience, and I had never asked a soul for money before. So they hired somebody like me, a lot like me. So me, it was me. As my good friend Amy says, "Well, slap my fanny." I guess I should have asked more questions before I took the job. That said, it probably would not have mattered. The board didn't know either. The GLAAD brand may have been big, but the problems were way bigger. I impressed myself with a tough salary negotiation that proved meaningless because all they could afford to pay me was $360, but just a one-time payment. That was the sum total in the GLAAD bank account. How did I manage? Well, nobody handed me a book, that's for sure. I don't even remember anyone telling me that everything was going to be okay. It was my job to tell everyone else that everything was going to be okay. There was so much I didn't know. Like everything, it seemed. I wish there had been a book. One with practical advice about how to untangle this mess, written by someone who had stood in my shoes, written by someone who would be my advocate, help me realize that I was not alone, and maybe even make me laugh that I was sobbing over a piece of stationery. So I decided to write the book I wish someone had handed me. Because my experience as a nonprofit leader and then as a board member and major donor and today as the principal in a nonprofit consulting practice has taught me a great deal that I believe will help you as a nonprofit leader become more effective at your job and remind you of the joy you can find in being underpaid and overworked to save even the smallest part of the world. Maybe you are wondering how I untangled the knots at GLAAD without a book. We did indeed dig out. I left the organization 8 years later with a $1.5 million cash reserve, an $8 million budget, and a staff of over 40. But that's not what counts. We made an impact. Long before marriage equality, GLAAD put same-sex couples on the wedding pages of every major newspaper in America, starting with the New York Times. If you think there are too many gay characters on television, give it to me right between the eyes. Our work at GLAAD brought us there. If the name Matthew Shepard, the young gay man murdered in Wyoming in 1998, is familiar to you, it's because GLAAD shaped that into a national story, ensuring that any discussion about hate crimes be expanded to include sexual orientation, a lasting legacy for a young man from Laramie. How did we do it? The recipe is not unique to my leadership or to GLAAD. There are universal constants. Between my own personal experience and working with hundreds of board and nonprofit staff leaders, these constants are critical to either digging out, stabilizing, or taking your organization to a place of even greater impact. You need to rely on the strengths and power of those around you and see your varying stakeholder groups as a village, each with an important role to play in the success of your organization. Then there is the mission, your passion for it, and your ability to articulate it, why it's important, and what impact it is having on the world. I continue to be stunned by how infrequently leaders get this right. You have to cultivate your storytelling skills, and in so doing, you will cultivate your fundraising prowess. You have to recognize the skills and attributes of your staff and manage them with compassion and accountability. Now that is a delicate balance. You have to be transparent and authentic with success and with challenges. Recognize that you are slightly more like a tribe than a staff. See the board as a resource and invest time and energy in building a committed and diverse group. Be an active member of the board recruitment committee from day one. And seek out strong co-chairs and consider them partners. Avoid the yes folks. Strong chairs will give you great advice and ask tough questions. Try not to get defensive. And this pushback will make you a more effective leader. Once your organization stops teetering, budget money annually to build a reserve. Once you are able to pull your nose out of the cash flow worksheet, you can actually think ahead. So get to it. Where are the gaps? Are there constituents you are not serving that no other organization can serve as well as you? These conversations can lead to smart and bold strategies and fundable plans for the future. This is how to dig out, how to stabilize, how to thrive. This is the core of my advice to many of my clients, to the thousands who visit my blog weekly, and to the dozens who write weekly with questions. And this captures the spirit of the advice I hope will be valuable to you. But the single most important attribute of a nonprofit leader, board member, or staff leader, the attribute that is most critical in helping you to untangle knots, and the one that can move your organization from good to great, is joy. In my own experience as a staff leader and a board leader, along with work with all my clients I have had through the years, it is this attribute that creates standout leaders. They get it. It is a joy to be paid to advocate, feed the hungry, to change laws, to raise money, to create a strong infrastructure, all in the service of others. I believe deeply in the power of the nonprofit sector to change the world in ways large and small. If you have raised your hand to say, I want to help, I want to work here, I want to volunteer, I want to raise money for you, you are, in my book, nobility. Your work says something important about your character, your spirit, your commitment to a fair and just world, your integrity, your courage, your grit, and your perseverance. Not everyone makes this choice. Far too many people with time, connections, and capacity sit on the sidelines. You made a different choice. Your feet are firmly planted on the high road and know that you are admired by many, including me. I speak from experience. Traveling on the high road isn't easy, and it's messy. But if you love your organization, it's worth every minute. Nonprofits are messy. Not enough money, too many cooks, an overdose of passion. Leading nonprofits isn't easy. I'm here to help. I'm offering this book to share some of the most valuable lessons I've learned over my career. I'm also providing a free collection of valuable templates, checklists, and other downloadable resources at joangarry.com/resources. Chapter 1. The Superpowers of Nonprofit Leadership. Dear Joan, I've been with my organization for nearly 8 years, most recently in a development role. My predecessor has been the voice and face of the organization for nearly 25 years and has just retired. The board has offered me the ED position. This would be alien territory for me. I've been the relationship guy, and I keep the trains running on time. And the truth is, I'm not exactly sure what I would be getting into. I want to give this a go, but I think I need help and would like to retain you as a coach. My goal is simple. I want to learn to behave like an executive director. Signed, EDET. To behave like an executive director. A very good goal for an executive director, I might add. ET became a client, and we teased out exactly what he meant by this. To be a leader and not a department head. To worry about the whole organization and every stakeholder. To stare at cash flow and wonder about payroll. To take responsibility for partnering with the board so that its members can fulfill their obligations. To stand up at a gala and give an inspiring and motivational speech. To feel an overwhelming sense of responsibility for the communities you serve. It's a hard role to be in and a hard role to cast for. I'm currently working with a board that cannot agree on the role the executive director should play, and they are already interviewing candidates. Can you say cart before the horse? Who should a board be looking for? What matters? In small organizations, the staff leader really does do it all. A person who can inspire a group with her words and read a balance sheet? What skills and attributes matter? Do you have them? How do you cultivate them? And the decision is so important. In my experience, leadership transitions are the most destabilizing forces in a nonprofit organization. Try raising money when you are between executive directors. Enough said. What's interesting is that all these same issues and questions apply to board chairs as well. What should an organization be looking for in a board chair? Note, the correct answer is not pray that someone raises her hand and pick her. How might the skills and attributes of that person complement those of the staff leader? What skills and attributes matter? How do you cultivate them? A quiz. Before I give you the answer to these questions, let's try a little quiz. Are you currently a nonprofit ED, overwhelmed by the idea that you need to be all things to all people? A board chair enthusiastic about leading the board to support the staff? Or someone who aspires to change the world and make the for-profit to nonprofit leap? The quiz should put things into perspective and begin to reveal the superpowers you need to be an effective leader within a nonprofit. So riddle me this, Batmen and Batwomen. It's time to pick your next board chair or executive director. Here are the finalists. I just grabbed a few superhero prototypes. Lots of others exist out there. 1, Black Panther. 2, Spider-Man. 3, Elastigirl. 4, Kermit the Frog. Let's dissect this, shall we? Oh, apologies to Kermit, not a good word for frogs. Each of these four have amazing strengths. Perhaps at first blush, you figure any of them could be a 5-star nonprofit leader. Black Panther. This guy has some serious things going for him. Sometimes organizations just want someone to fly in and save the day. He's dripping with integrity and tells the truth. He is very smart. Would you say no to him if he asked you for a donation? His high-tech, energy-absorbing suit, designed by his STEM-strong sister, is fabulous, not to mention the stylish claw necklace. Spider-Man. Lots of appeal here, too. He's human, powerful, and nerdy. He's vulnerable, but strong. Some comic book fanatics say he is the single greatest superhero of them all. He has real humanity, vulnerabilities, guilt, and flaws. He's driven. Peter Parker, the man behind Spider-Man, helps people because he understands the price of not doing it. He could have prevented his uncle's death. He grows into his power. The responsibility of leadership is not something he asks for, but he accepts it and uses that responsibility to the best of his ability. Elastigirl. When I think about Helen Parr, aka Mrs. Incredible, and Elastigirl and Mom, I am reminded that not everything is black and white, and that being flexible is absolutely key to success in any setting. Is Elastigirl your choice? She's well-rounded, very optimistic, would lead with an optimism that her organization could change the world. She's someone you want to be around. Kind, warm-hearted, and generous. She has real humanity, vulnerabilities, guilt, flaws. Kermit. Another guy with some solid skills and attributes for nonprofit leadership. A team builder, he can bring a diverse group together. Anyone who can get Gonzo, Fozzie, and Miss Piggy working toward a common goal has a real superpower. Kermit is an optimist, but not a Pollyanna. He can get down sometimes too, but in the end, he has a vision and rallies the Muppets around it. He cares deeply about doing the right thing. Kermit is your go-to guy in a crisis. Strong planning skills. His ego is just the right size. He can and does admit mistakes. Time to put the four of them to the test. Here's the kind of situation each of them may encounter. Then you get to make your choice. You need a new board chair. The previous leader didn't want the job. Might have been in the restroom during elections. Committees are dormant. The board does a decent job selling tickets to your big gala, but half of them don't want to pay for a ticket themselves. The founder of the organization is a big personality, and when she stepped down 2 years ago, she offered to join the board, and your previous board chair couldn't say no. She isn't letting go of the job. Your ED is a good performer, but the founder is driving her mad. You are worried she may be recruited away. Who is the right person for the job? Black Panther is the command-controlled nonprofit leader. The world is quite black and white for him. He would see board members as good guys or bad guys. We know it's not that simple. Nonprofit leadership demands both an understanding of and an appreciation for nuance and the land of the gray. We know this type. A good leader to dig you out fast, but not the marathon guy. Spider-Man is a more empathetic, three-dimensional leader. His downfall is the challenge of many leaders. Insecurity. Elastigirl? What a nice woman. Who wouldn't want to sit and hear about an organization from somebody like Helen Parr? She is a relationship builder of the highest order. But her fatal leadership flaw? She is a pleaser. A bit too flexible. Now, most nonprofit leaders have some pleaser stuff going on, but if it drives you, you are done for. You have various stakeholders, and pleasing everyone usually means pleasing no one. Your job isn't about pleasing, it's about serving your mission. Okay, so I've given the answer away. My vote goes to Kermit. Hands down. First off, Kermit would have figured out some way to give the founder a big role with no real power. Look how he manages Piggy. He would rally the troops without shaming them. He would find the key strength in each board member and bring out the best in each of them. He would not be overly bossy with the ED. He'd offer his support and be more like a coach. And he would help staff and board keep their eyes on the prize, never losing sight of the organization's mission and vision. Kermit may not thrive in a hierarchical work environment, but he'd be a rock star ED or board chair. Kermit is not perfect, and he knows it. This trait is key to effective leadership. It makes him a good delegator. He is all about team, and he understands the value each team member brings to the work. He believes in diversity. He likes to work to reach consensus, but never loses sight of the end game. He stays true to the cause. He is fair and listens, and he can manage high-maintenance personalities without sacrificing the work. I also think he can disagree, and his team ultimately listens and respects his decisions. Decisions they feel were made with their input. Kermit understands what it takes to be a great leader in the nonprofit sector. 1. Understanding that power comes from all around you. 2. Recognizing that developing core leadership attributes is as important as skills building. You're not on top of anything. In 1997, as the executive director of the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, GLAAD, I was approached by the Coors Brewing Company. Coors was interested in making a $50,000 corporate sponsorship donation to GLAAD. As our organization was still on a financial respirator, I was interested, very interested. But I knew the history of Coors and the gay community. The Coors family had deep ties to the Heritage Foundation, a significant funder of organizations leading the opposition to LGBTQ equality. As a result, there had been a long-standing boycott in the gay community. Drink any beer you like, but not Coors. A discussion with Coors illustrated to me that the company was better on gay issues inside its organization, domestic partner benefits, and other non-discrimination policies than many other companies who sponsored GLAAD. Should I accept the sponsorship money and in so doing help rebuild the Coors brand in the gay community? The decision was mine to make. Or was it? In Jim Collins' monograph, Good to Great and the Social Sectors, Why Business Thinking is Not the Answer, he makes the case that power and decision-making in the nonprofit sector are different from and messier than what they are in the private sector. To be a great leader, you must erase your preconceived notions of what it means to be in charge, starting with a standard org chart. You probably have a piece of paper that shows this kind of hierarchy. Time to recycle. Is it factually accurate? Yep. Is it how you should look at, exert your power as a nonprofit leader? Absolutely not. In the standard org chart, the Coors decision is easy. I make a statement about the changes at Coors, accept the donation, make payroll, and let the chips fall where they may. In the nonprofit sector, a leader is beholden to vast and diverse stakeholders. I was hired to run GLAAD in the service of moving the needle forward on equal rights for the community I served. The bottom line matters, of course, but only to ensure that you have sufficient resources to work in the service of your mission. In the nonprofit sector, the executive director derives power from all around her. This is why former Girl Scout ED Frances Heiselbein once told a reporter that she saw herself in the center and that she was, quote, not on top of anything, end quote. So what did this mean for the Coors decision? The voices of the stakeholder groups around me were critical. I needed to be well-informed. I needed strong input from different groups. And I needed a thought partner in my board chair to kick around the pros and cons. I knew the decision was ultimately mine, but I never really thought of it that way. We were all in this together. My development director, the one I'd nearly killed in this book's introduction, was outraged and feared we would lose more money than we earned. We did our due diligence and determined that would not be the case. The staff was mixed. Some worried I would be eaten alive by the press, given my own corporate background. Others thought it was unfair to Coors, when in fact, by corporate standards, they were leaders. This kind of power demands that you meet with the leaders of the Coors Boycott Committee. Not to empower them, but to ensure their voices are heard. We even invited them to a board meeting. And this kind of power demands that you see the decision from all sides. We secured a meeting with the most senior people at Coors and garnered commitments from them to do more than just donate money. And this kind of power demanded that I put myself at a national LGBTQ conference in which several hundred community members could share their distaste with the thought that GLAAD may make this choice. In this setting, you can be sure that I heard them. Many of them were yelling at me. In the end, Coors became a corporate sponsor of GLAAD. Not everyone agreed, but everyone had a voice. All stakeholder groups were heard, and our entire process and strategy was smarter and more effective than any decision I had made on my own. This is what Jim Collins means when he talks about power in the nonprofit sector being diffuse. At its best, it creates a staff that feels valued and heard, a supportive board comfortable in challenging, and a membership that sees a process rich with integrity. Nonprofit decision-making at its best. So you can see how this can get messy, right? How quickly a staff can become disgruntled. So can your clients. You want them to be engaged in the work, to secure their opinions about decisions and policies, but you must walk a fine line. If you don't, you wind up with angry stakeholders, and you wind up fighting to make decisions that are in the best interest of the entire organization. How about a board chair that has already made up their mind about the ED annual review process and doesn't ask for input? How valuable does the full board feel? I'm going to go with not very. Or how about an ED who has already made a big decision and asks the senior staff to weigh in? That ED better pray the senior staff comes up with the same decision. Then there is the ED who listens to input and finds themselves more indecisive than when they first asked. Each of these scenarios makes things messier. What do I do with all this? Not everyone is Kermit, and no one fits neatly into one of the four superhero profiles. You might identify with someone outside the list. I hope there are no Darth Vaders among you. The key is to recognize attributes that don't serve you well and make adjustments. So for me, I think I am a BPK, a Black Panther Kermit combo. Yes, I am now making fun of every personality profile test to which you've ever been subjected at work or during a retreat. I am a fixer. I know this about myself. I love to save the day. That's why I love my work. I have serious Black Panther tendencies. They serve me well in my business, but as a nonprofit leader, not so much. I like to think I have some Kermit going on as well. Like Kermit, I like to think of myself as an orchestra conductor, bringing out the best in my tribe. So what if you aren't Kermit? Black Panther tendencies. Thomas arrived as the new ED of a pretty small organization. Budget size, a few hundred thousand. Thomas wears a cape, and not just on Halloween. He arrived at his organization to fix it, to save the day. The organization had been in disarray for some time. Thomas started weekly staff meetings, and no one came. Well, some did, but most didn't. They were too busy. Thomas was angry, and he threatened consequences. The following week, attendance was better, still not great. Attitudes were even worse. What was he missing? Thomas made several incorrect assumptions. One, if you tell people what to do, they will just do it. Now, that worked like a charm for me in Catholic grammar school in the 1960s, but in a nonprofit, your staff needs to feel some sense of ownership of the decisions made. This is what they deserve in lieu of that year-end bonus that is coming like never. 2, he assumed they understood. In this case, he assumed they understood the value of a staff meeting. That's not how the previous leader managed or didn't. So here are the changes I suggested that he make. 1, have a meeting about the meeting. Send an email around. Tell folks that this meeting is to talk about how a staff meeting might be valuable to the entire group and to each staffer. Let them figure out the need themselves. And yes, everyone showed up. They built a standing agenda that was more than just reporting out, and staff meetings are now weekly and well attended. 2, ask more questions. Cape wearers are fixers, and they know the answers. Maybe they are arrogant or maybe just very self-assured. Thomas liked to just tell staff the answers. He directed them closely because he was clear about what needed to be done. I encouraged Thomas to ask staff members what they would do. Have a conversation about strategy. Guide gently if they are off base. And more importantly, listen carefully. You know, it is possible that they are right and you are not. I know, hard to believe. 3, dip your toe into the world of the gray. To Black Panther, things are black and white. There are good guys and bad guys. Things need to happen a certain way. You need to try to appreciate the gray. This might mean you have to own the fact that you are not as open-minded as you need to be. Are you a board chair ready to write off a board member who does nothing? Try having a coffee with said board member. Ask her what success looks like for her, what she needs from the chair to be successful. Don't vote her off the island too quickly. Move from black to gray. Spider-Man tendencies. Unlike T'Challa, Black Panther, who is clearly a respected leader of his people, Peter Parker is a three-dimensional teenager, a nerd, an introvert, and an outsider, a sensitive soul who has experienced tragedy and loss. Spidey, on the other hand, owns his brilliance and is all about victory. But both Peter and Spidey share two key things. A, the importance of the intersection of knowledge and power, and B, a core value to lead a responsible life. Kim began her job as a board chair, deeply insecure about her ability to do a good job. Get in line, Kim. She was now in charge of a sizable board filled with some very high-powered folks. If you spent an hour with this group and someone asked you who the chair was, she would not be your obvious choice. She was not a great public speaker and was intimidated by the resumes of those folks around the table, none of whom, by the way, were willing to step into the leadership role. But Kim knew the organization needed someone dedicated, someone who loved the organization and really wanted the staff leader to succeed. Kim's challenge was not to be overrun by the bombastic folks in the room, to establish leadership. But Kim doesn't wear a cape. In our coaching sessions, Kim and I spoke about where her power comes from. I learned that she was deeply empathetic and had a profound and personal connection to the mission. I also learned that she was smart as hell. The following shifts helped Kim quite a bit. 1, be the most knowledgeable person in the room. I'm not talking about smarts. I'm talking about the professional aspects of the role of board chair. I begged her to buy Robert's Rules of Order. It is amazing how much respect a board chair can garner when managing a meeting professionally. I also encouraged her to spend time really understanding the nonprofit sector and the complexities and context of the issue the organization was up against. 2, play to your strengths. Remember Kim's empathy? Remember her introvert tendencies? We devised a regular email from the board chair. It opened with a story about the work or something Kim had learned about the broader context of the work, reminding board members why they serve. Then she was able to call board members to action. She had put the requests into an emotional and intellectual context. Elastigirl tendencies. Pleasers cause themselves heaps of trouble. Stretching yourself thin to make everyone happy inevitably backfires in nearly every situation, from a kindergarten classroom to a boardroom to a staff meeting. The most important lesson I have learned about Elastigirl leaders is that if you can help them draw a picture of what happens as a result of pleasing, it makes them really unhappy. Elastigirls respond in the moment and do not anticipate well. It's kind of like an automatic camera, point and shoot. Trouble to the left? Let me fix it. Conflicting trouble to the right? I'll make you happy too. But they can't look far enough down the road to see the implications. Tina is an ED of a direct service organization that has a very strong client advocacy group.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.